So after the implementation details, I will discuss the solution algorithm. So the solution algorithm is, as I said, that the first part of any code is preprocessor, and in preprocessor, basically what we do is that there are certain user inputs. Like in the codes which we had given, you will have to enter what is the density of the material, specific heat of the material, conductivity of the material. So the material property is one of the input, thermophysical property in general. Then there will be some geometrical parameter. What is the length of the plate, height of the plate, what is the maximum want in the x and y directions, what are the boundary conditions input. We have given you a code where which is made general, like although it is in Cartesian coordinate system. So when the code is in Cartesian coordinate system, it is expected that the boundary will be having a left wall, right wall, bottom wall and top wall. However, there are switches, like on the left wall, whether you want Dirichlet boundary condition, Neumann means insulated, or convective boundary conditions. Actually, we have given four options, if I remember: constant wall temperature, insulated boundary condition, constant heat flux boundary condition, and convective boundary condition. Because these are the four common boundary conditions which you see in heat transfer. So there are certain boundary conditions input corresponding to each wall, and then there is a convergence criteria to check whether your code has reached to steady state. So these are some of the inputs. Then there is a grid generation. In this case, we are following a simplest form of grid generation where we need to calculate the coordinates of the vertices of equispaced horizontal and intersection of the equispaced horizontal and vertical lines. But when you generate grids, you calculate the width of the control volume, distance between the cell centers, surface areas and the volumes. Then you set the initial guess. The code which we are discussing here is an unsteady state code. So for this, you need an initial condition. So the problems which will be given you, there will be an initial condition also. Note that here I am setting that you set the Dirichlet boundary condition. I am not talking of non-Dirichlet boundary condition. Non-Dirichlet boundary condition I had put in separate step. Why? Note that the boundary condition I am in step 3, I am writing only Dirichlet boundary condition. In step 4, I am writing non-Dirichlet boundary condition. Why? In Dirichlet and non-Dirichlet, what happens? The boundary values, what happens? It changes with respect to time. It is a function of border point. Boundary point is a function of border point whenever you have a gradient boundary conditions. And you know, border point is a part of inside the domain, which changes with respect to time. So whenever you have a non-Dirichlet boundary condition, what a non-Dirichlet? Neumann or Robin type of, which I discussed earlier. For those type of boundary condition, you have a gradient, and you get, when you discretize it, you get boundary point as a function of border point, which changes with respect to time. So this has to be brought inside the loop. After each time marching, you have to update this boundary point value as a function of border point. Before you go to computation, you, whatever temperature you have now, take it as an old value. Then I had done input step for each phases, calculate heat Qx and Qy. Then do a balance and calculate total heat gained by conduction, and then finally temperature. Once you have got temperature, then you check for convergence. There are two ways of checking the convergence. In fact, there are many ways, but one of the common ways is that one of the simplest way is that between two consecutive time step at each point, let us say there are 25 yellow circles. So you will have 25 temperature from the previous time step and from the new time step. So you calculate the 25 differences of those temperature, and out of those 25 difference values, whichever one is the maximum, you use a small program to obtain the maximum of a matrix. That maximum you check for steady state criteria. But a better way, it has been found that instead of taking the absolute difference, if you take the RMS of the difference, so you take the difference between the present and old time, take it square at all the, so at 25 points you take the difference, take it square, take mean of that and take the square root of that. So this, instead of taking the absolute different, absolute maximum difference, this is considered to be better. So we take the root mean square value of the temperature difference, and that is what in your code you see RMS, it has been defined, given a name as RMS residue, if I am not wrong. So this is used to check the unsteadiness. But many a time, now many times the question comes whether we should call delta t, is it tending to 0 as steady state, or whether we should have del capital T by del small t tending to 0 as steady state. Okay, so if you ensure this, you ensure, try to ensure that delta t can tends to 0. But if you divide by delta t time step, you try to ensure del capital T by del small t tends to 0. However, if you are using an explicit method and use this criteria, for conduction this works properly, there is not much problem. But when, especially when you are solving, we had seen that if you solve a natural convection problem and if the temperatures are very large, then the velocity inside in natural convection increases tremendously, then the time step varies a lot. So what happens is this temperature difference between two, let us say consecutive time step, goes down. But if the, by stability criteria, if your delta T is increasing, then this this value oscillates a lot. So for I suggest that it's better to use this boundary condition, because sometimes this causes a lot of stability problem. Okay. So in the code, finally we have used this boundary condition, but I just wanted to mention here. If it has converged, means it has reached to steady state. If not, you go back to, there is a mistake here, it has to go back to step 4, not step 5, because in step 4 you have non-Dirichlet boundary condition. You have to go back to step 4, where you have a non-Dirichlet boundary condition, where boundary is a function of border value. So this loop goes on and on till you reach to a steady state, till this RMST is less than equal to epsilon, which is a convergence criteria, maybe 10 to power minus 3. Okay, so this completes the formulation, the implementation detail, and solution algorithm. Any question on this? It's very important that you understand this. I'll repeat again, in the formulation we have used two levels of approximation. Let us say in case of diffusion, the first level of approximation was whenever you take a control volume to calculate total heat gained by conduction, you express heat transfer as fluxes on the faces. So the first level of approximation corresponds to how to represent the heat fluxes at the faces, how to write qx, qx plus delta x, qy, qy plus delta y on the surfaces as one point value. Because qx varies all over the vertical surface, qy varies all over the horizontal surface. So this approximation is first level of approximation. What is the second level of approximation? How to write Fourier law of heat conduction in algebraic form, how to convert the differential form of Fourier law of heat conduction into algebraic form. We basically use second order central difference scheme, piecewise linear approximation. To represent heat flux at faces, we use centroid value, which is also second order approximation. These two approximations we used and we get algebraic equations. Then I talked about the solution methodology, explicit method and an implicit method. Then I talked about how when you want to develop the code, let us do in stages, because formulation also we did in stages. So let us develop code in stages. Let us first calculate qx, qy. For that we use a discrete form of Fourier law of heat conduction. For that we use some convention. I had even shown some symbols, some colorful squares and triangles, so that you get a picture of, in your mind, it's not mathematics, it's some picture which you see and you know what physically you want to do. You want to balance the heat, and then once you have balanced the heat, to know the temperature evolution, you basically apply rate of change of internal energy is equal to total heat gained by conduction. Okay, and then and finally I had shown you step by step procedure as a solution algorithm. Any question, please? Okay. So let us suppose there is a plate of length L1 in the x direction, L2 in the y direction. I will take two class of heat transfer problem. One where I'll take all Dirichlet boundary condition. So all Dirichlet means I take, let us say, left wall 100, bottom wall 200, right wall 300, top wall 400 degrees centigrade. And for this, if you use the formulation, the implementation details, and if you develop the code using the solution algorithm, finally you create a movie. where at each time step, if you have stored the temperature, for each time step you get one picture. So for this case, if you take a steel plate, so in your code you, there will be density, specific heat and conductivity as a property. And this is the way the initial condition is 100 degrees centigrade in this problem. This is isotherm. Note that left wall is always blue, 100 degrees centigrade. Bottom wall is always green, 200. Right wall, orange, 300. Top wall, close to white, 400. Boundary condition should not change with respect to time. This is just one of the check. Let me tell you, in research, we don't know what results we will get, but we should be clever enough to know what result we should not get. So if you develop a code and where you are finding that your left wall is not 100, bottom wall is not 200, so if it's not obeying the boundary condition, how can you expect that your results will be correct? Okay, so the purpose, one of the implicit purpose of this course is that to make you clever enough that when you use CFD, you know that at least this result I should not get. Or if your student comes with some result, you should say, no, you are wrong. Just by looking into the, not going into the details of the result, just looking into the result, you can understand. I will give you some more hint to know how good or bad a result is, or whether it's a physical or it is not. Okay, now whenever, many times you may feel that I can use a software and get engineering parameters, and let us suppose for flow across a car or flow across an aeroplane, I will calculate lift force and drag force, but what is the need of that creating that movie? Let us say for flow across a car, fluid dynamic movie. There is a need. If you want to understand the fluid dynamics phenomena, I would say that is more of a scientific investigation. If you want to understand that, okay, if you have designed 10 different shapes of the car, and let us suppose you do CFD simulation and you find that one of the design is giving least drag force. Okay. But the reason why that design is giving least drag force, if you create a fluid dynamic movie and not only velocity contours, or let us say velocity vectors or pressure contours, you may have to draw vorticity contours. You may have to develop some other tool to understand, because fluid dynamics is not that easy that you create one type of movie and you can understand everything. Many a times we don't, as I mentioned, cannot say with certainty that drag force is reducing due to this. There are many reasons, because it's a highly coupled problem. So similarly, here I want to give you a message that once you get this type of temperature distribution, it has some story. What is that story? Bottom wall is at 200 degrees centigrade. Can you talk about the rate of heat transfer in the bottom wall? This is, note that this is a steady state heat conduction with no volumetric heat generation. So the solution has to be bounded, and there cannot be local maxima in the temperature distribution. So what I mean is that, let us suppose if this is at 200, this is at 250, so all the point between in this region will be in between 200 and 250. It cannot be less than 200 or greater than 250. There cannot be a local minima or a local maxima. If you have a volumetric heat generation, then it may happen that you can have a local maximum. But there also it's not necessary. It depends upon the magnitude of volumetric heat generation as well as the boundary conditions. So near to the bottom wall, by looking into this temperature distribution, bottom wall is at 200 degrees centigrade. Can you make a statement on the direction of heat transfer? At what, which point heat transfer will be zero on the bottom wall? Bottom wall is at 200. There is an isotherm 200 which is heating it. So at this point, rate of heat transfer will be zero. It is heating normally. dT by dy will be zero. What about left part of this wall? Temperatures are what? 150, 160, 170, 180, 190, 200. So temperature is here, bottom wall 200. In this region, temperature is less than 200. So heat transfer will be upward. Here it will be, here it is greater than 200, 210, 220, 230, 240 and so on. Here heat transfer will be downward. So this picture they speak something. Okay, so many times when you get, if you plot, let us suppose in this wall, how qy varies with respect to x. So this picture says that it should change its direction, it should pass through zero. Initially it should be upward and then it should go to downward, crossing zero smoothly. So this, with this I wanted to give you an idea that when if you plot the engineering parameter, such as in this case I have taken a simplest of the problem, the variation of qy as a function of y, this is called as local heat fluxes. This local values, when you do post processing, in the next slide maybe I'll show you. So on the top wall, you see everywhere the temperature is less than 400, so heat transfer is inward. On the right wall, what you see is left wall is 100 and near everywhere it is greater than 100, so heat transfer is outward. On the bottom wall, there is change in the direction of the heat transfer. And in the right wall also, there is change in the direction of heat transfer. Okay, so this picture gives the reason why there is change in the direction of heat flux on the right wall and bottom wall. Now, how do we calculate? Because once you get a run a CFD code, you get a temperature distribution. But how do you calculate this heat fluxes at the boundary? Actually, the way I had given you the formulation, the codes, we are calculating Qx, Qy. So it is automatically calculated in this formulation. Okay, but if you are solving, let us suppose, by finite difference method where you are obtaining temperature distribution. So let us suppose your coding doesn't involve Qx, Qy, because you can develop code in that way also. And if you want to calculate Q, because this Qx, Qy, strictly speaking, as an engineer, you need it only near to the boundary, not interior of the domain. So many times you may feel that it is unnecessary, but I had shown you because I felt that this is easy way to understand when you want to develop into code. So normally if temperature distribution is known, then at this boundary, what we do is that, how do you calculate Qy? Here you will have to calculate Qy. So Qy is equal to minus k del t by del y. So you need to calculate del t by del y at this boundary point using the border point. Note that here you have to use one-sided difference, like forward difference. So let us suppose at the bottom wall, left wall it is 100, bottom wall it is 200. So if you use dt by dy, so this temperature minus this temperature divided by the distance between the two points, you can calculate del t by del y multiplied by minus k and then see. So what I wanted to show you here is that you can see that in this three values are less than 200, here the heat transfer will be zero, here the values are greater than 200. So there is a change in the magnitude of temperature from the left part to the right part across 200. So if you plot at the bottom wall, which is this, I think, red inverted triangle, what you see is that initially it is positive, then it crosses the zero, then it becomes negative on the bottom wall. So note that we do numerical differentiation to calculate the local value of heat fluxes. So in the bottom wall, the heat flux, let us suppose you have 5 points, so you will get 5 different values. But many times we are interested in one value. Then you have to do numerical integrations. So numerical differentiation is needed to calculate the local heat flux. And you need to do numerical integration to calculate the total heat fluxes. Many times if you are teaching a course on numerical methods, you can take this as an example for numerical differentiation and numerical integrations. These are good examples from heat transfer. We do this in our first course, which we call as the computational methods in thermal and fluid engineering. This is the second class of boundary condition. Left wall, now I have all types of boundary condition. Dirichlet, Neumann, and Robin-Normix type of boundary condition. Left wall 100, bottom wall insulated, right wall constant heat flux, top wall convective boundary conditions. Now in this case, when it's a Dirichlet boundary condition, it's easy to apply the boundary condition, because it's just the value which you have to give to the blue circles. But in this case, you need to discretize. Like this is insulated, del t by del y is zero. So the temperature here is equal to this. The temperature here is equal to this. So this is written as T at all I, j is equal to 1, is equal to T at all I, j is equal to 2. This is the discretization of constant heat flux boundary condition. This is the discretization of Robin or mixed type of boundary condition. Minus k dT by dy is equals to h temperature at the wall minus T infinity. And this is the Dirichlet boundary condition. So note that whether you are applying finite volume method, but the discretization of the boundary condition is done by finite difference method. So that's why some amount of finite difference was very necessary before going to the finite volume method.
What I would do now, first we will calculate the temperature.
Yeah.
Once it is converted, then once we calculate heat flux values.
Yeah.
What is the need not to calculate every time?
There is no need. Yeah. As I said, that there is no need. Hmm. It's just that I feel that this is, when you are coding, you have the feel of what you are doing. Okay. But you can avoid it. It's not necessary. It is just to have a better understanding of the conservation laws, and the formulation and the coding. I wanted to have a same relationship between all of them. So that's why I followed this approach. For a beginner, it is good. But later on, it's not necessary. It takes unnecessary computation time. Now for this problem, let us suppose left wall is at 100 degree centigrade, bottom wall insulated. Right, top wall, let us suppose there is a force convection with H is equals to 100 watt per meter square Kelvin. And the ambient temperature is 30 degree centigrade. Right wall, suppose let us say wall heat flux is 10 kilowatt per meter square. So for this type of animations which you will get for temperature distribution. Now here again, by looking into this animation, you can understand whether it is correct or not. How? You should know what is your boundary condition, and by looking into each of this picture, you can say it is correct or not. Because from the boundary condition, you know the slope of the line. Bottom wall is insulated. So the isotherm should be in hitting perpendicular. See this animation. In each picture, just see at the wall, not away from the wall. At the wall, it is hitting normally, first thing. Second thing, right wall, you have a constant heat flux. So this will not hit normal, that's okay. But what is dT by dx equals to minus qw by k. So the slope has to be constant. So note that in this animation on the right wall, each isotherm is hitting at same constant angle. Okay, so whenever you are doing CFD simulation, whenever you get some result, be clever enough to judge from the boundary conditions or the flow structures near to the boundary, that whether your result is seems to be physical or is just a numerical artifact. Okay. This is a steady state temperature distribution. Okay, just I would like to point out for a beginner, as far as this graphics is concerned, once we get the temperature distribution, you can you get in a matrix form, and then you take it to a software. And what you need to do is that you need to give the x coordinate of the yellow circle points and blue circle points, the y coordinate of that, and the temperature value. And then you can use a command, contour command, and then you can get. And there are two types of contours. Earlier, what animation which I was showing, it's a flooded color contour. And what is shown here is the line contours. Okay. So here you have an isotherms which are represented by line. And in the previous animation, it is a flooded contour. Okay. So although there is a line also, there is a combination. There is an overlap plot between of the flooded contour and the line contours. So this contour here represents the isotherms. This is the steady state variation. Okay, now here again the same thing happens. Left wall is at 100. There is a top half where the temperature nearby is less than 100. Bottom half which is greater. So there is change in the direction of heat flux on the left wall. Bottom wall is insulated, so no heat transfer. Top wall, you have a convective boundary condition. So there is a heat loss from the top wall. Right wall, you have a constant heat flux. So it will have inward heat flow. Here again, if you plot, here I have plotted the heat flux on the left wall. So you can see that on the bottom portion of the left wall, the heat transfer is negative. it crosses through a zero and then it becomes positive. So there is a change in the direction of heat flux on the left wall. So that completes the conduction in Cartesian coordinate system. I was not planning in cylindrical coordinate system, but I think in Professor Buranik's lecture somebody mentioned that if we can incorporate cylindrical coordinate system also, so that's why I included. But the idea which I had used in Cartesian coordinate, same idea is used here. It is just that the geometrical parameters which are involved are different. And moreover, let us suppose if you are taking in a polar coordinate system, same use the same law of conservation of energy, rate of change of internal energy equals to heat gained by conduction plus heat generation, which you can represent as this. So there I was showing you Qx, Qy. Now if you take a polar control volume, what you have happens is that you get heat transfer in the radial direction and angular direction. And in this case, the surface area are different. The surface area here is in a 2D case delta R on both the surface. And here it will be R plus delta R into delta phi, this will be R delta phi. So the surface area, in this case what you find is that the surface area changes along the radial direction, which does not happen in case of x and y direction. Other than that, the way we do the discretization, it's almost same. Okay, so if you want to calculate this, there is one yellow circle lying here, one yellow circle lying here. So all those ideas we use, actually right now in this slide, I think what I am trying to show you is that you can get the differential equation. How you get the differential equation in your heat transfer course in cylindrical coordinate system? You do a balance and divide by the volume, use the limits. So this is the differential equation in cylindrical coordinate system. In the next slide, I show you the algebraic form. So this is the first level of approximation, where what you do is that at all the four surfaces, you represent the heat fluxes at the centroid of each of the surfaces. So you have centroid represented as east, west, north, south. So instead of writing Q phi, Q phi plus delta phi, Q R plus delta R, you write the values at centroids as subscript. And then you calculate, do the balance. So from the negative faces, it's coming in, from the positive faces, it's going out. So in minus out is the total heat gain. And the second level of approximation is you do the discretization. The Fourier law of heat conduction is slightly different in cylindrical coordinate system as compared to Cartesian coordinate system. So this is the discrete representation of Fourier law of heat conduction in cylindrical coordinate system. So delta phi is the angle between these two points. Rp is the radius at point P. So these are the geometrical parameters which are involved. So with this you can calculate that this QE, QW, QN and QS, and then you do a balance. And then the procedure is very much similar to what I had shown in the conduction. Even you can develop a general purpose code both for conduction and cylindrical, Cartesian and cylindrical coordinate system. All, and only what will vary is the geometrical parameters. Like the denominator may be in a Cartesian coordinate system, this was delta x, here it is Rp delta phi. The geometrical parameters will only vary. And this is the explicit, when you use an explicit method, this is the final. So in this, from the second level of approximation, if you substitute this Q into the expression which you have got in the first level of approximation, you get the final equation as this. And as we are calculating the total heat gained by conduction using the temperature of the previous time level, this is an explicit method. So for explicit method, this is the equation, discretized equation. I will not go into much detail in cylindrical coordinate system, but I would like to mention here that in a cylindrical coordinate system, you have boundaries, let us say in this problem at least, polar coordinate system. Let us suppose you have a plate with a circular hole, circular plate with a circular hole. So there is an inner boundary and there is an outer boundary, both are circle. R is equals to R1, R is equals to R2. So in this case, what you find is that you do not have a computational boundary in the angular direction. So if you are solving for, because this is circular, so what happens is that if you want to solve for this, this is one of the neighbor, this is another neighbor. Actually, when we want to develop a code, even if it is in a cylindrical coordinate system, we want to map this point in Cartesian coordinate system. like this. Because we need to scroll in some, starting from some point. I need to start my I from some point. Let us say I start my J from the center in this direction. Let us suppose my I is starting in the anti-clockwise direction from here. So this is my I is equals to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. But I, when I am solving for, let us say this point, I need one neighbor behind. So what I do is that I don't put this as 1, I put this as 2. And the value of this 1 will be equal to the last. So what I want to tell you is that what is blinking here as this green line, actually I say that this is a zero volume control volume. Here I have some, actually if you want to draw the domain, this, when it has to pick its east boundary, it has to pick this value. So for the I is equals to 1, what I do is that for all j, I is equals to 1, in the, when we apply the boundary condition, it's what is called as periodic boundary conditions. So the boundary value is equals to the last border value. So the first boundary value, left boundary value is the, so what is the last border value? This one. If you move in this direction, which is the last yellow circle which you will encounter? This one. So the way we apply boundary condition is that the value at I is equals to 1 is equals to the last yellow circle. And the boundary condition at I max is equals to the first yellow circle. This is what is called as periodic boundary condition in CFD. So we need to make a branch cut so that you can map it like a Cartesian, because finally when you want to scroll in this fashion. Where at the I is equals to 1 and I is equals to I max, you use a periodic boundary conditions. Here again I had used the same, instead of Qx, I have Q in the theta direction and Q in the radial direction instead of Qy. Here again I am showing you a pseudocode, but this pseudocode will be slightly different from the earlier pseudocode because of the periodicity. You need not calculate Qx on that branch cut. That's why there is slight difference. You can go into the details little later. But what I, maybe I can go to the figure and point out. In this case, I need heat fluxes on this face as a function of these two values. And this I need only once. So there is a periodicity so that I can avoid using the type of loops which you see in the theta and the r direction are a little different. Because in the theta direction, it is starting from 2. But in the j direction, j is starting from 1. But with, so in earlier case, this q was j was starting from 1. But in qx, I was starting from 1. But in this case, there is a slight difference due to that periodicity. As far as calculated, this is calculation of q in the theta direction. This is the calculation of q in the radial direction. And then once you have calculated q in the theta and the radial direction, you do a balance and then finally calculate the temperature of the new time levels. So I think with this, I had come to the end of this lecture on heat conduction.